again. We're headed northwest. We're the guys of the Southwest Pacific Fleet. Maybe you've heard of us. Midway, Coral Sea, Java Sea, Guadalcanal. That was us. We're not much different than any other Navy bunch. A lot of young kid ensigns doing okay, a lot of hands fresh out of boot, a few chiefs with hash marks up to their chins. It's a good outfit. This particular trip was important, though. We had the army along, 50,000 of them. We were going to invade Rendova that night in combined operations, another big step in the strategy that our fleet commander, Admiral Halsey, has been following from the beginning. We hove to off Rendova Island a few hours before dawn, morning of June 30th, 1943. And first, we did a little talking with the Japs. From the beginning, the damn thing worked. Part of it was luck, rain. Part of it was the class of our guys. But most of it was the plans and the staff that had drawn them up. It had been Army, Navy, and Marines combined, planning together as one staff. Within 2 hours, big barges had put almost all the Army and Marines ashore on Rendova Beach. Within 3 hours, they'd reformed regiments and battalions. Within 6 hours, those tough monkeys had either killed every Jap or driven them back into the mountains. Marines had cut security outposts from the jungle moss inland. We kept stuff rolling into them, as much and as fast as we could on the stopwatch. By the time the Army got their long toms on the beach, Rendova was captured in a walkaway. Those self-propelled 155s were a little Army surprise for the Japs and for Munda Airfield across the bay. In the middle of that afternoon, the rain clouds stretched apart to give us a look at our own air umbrella. Army-Navy flyers had knocked down 345 Jap planes and lost only 84. One Jap dive bomber squadron did find a hole and busted through, getting a small dump near the plantation. Right away, the soldiers and gyrenes started their land fight to the airfield, inching through swamps and jungle ambushes on their bellies, yard by yard, 24 hours a day, closer and closer to the field, supported by the damnedest concentration of three-dimensional firepower you ever saw. The long toms, ships, power. We threw it at him and kept it going. We'd lost two ships and rescued most of the survivors. We'd accounted for 28 Jap warships sunk with all hands. By the time we picked those survivors up, they were pretty damn hungry and tired, oil-soaked, and quiet. It's a mean feeling in the Navy to lose your ship. You get attached to her, proud, like you're proud of the Navy. It was cleaning up to do. Empty shells to be recased and stashed. And then we snatched sleep, quick, in any way we could, to catch up for that next round. Four on, eight off, for the duration.
It's reveille time down on the farm. These young ladies are this year's farmhands being called to work by the farmer's wife, who used to wake up the men before they left for the armed forces. The girls live in barracks and keep regular workers' hours. They are part of the great volunteer army mobilized because of the manpower shortage to bring in the much-needed crops. Scenes like this are taking place on farms all over the country as tens of thousands of teenage boys and girls answer the call and go off to the fields where the bumper crops of food and ammunition are ripe and ready. Everybody works, and nothing goes to waste. There'll be plenty of good food for the American fighting man wherever he goes, and for the folks at home, even if it is rationed. The war is everybody's war, and everybody is fighting it one way or another. These volunteer workers have energy, willingness, and high spirits. New skills are quickly taught and learned. A student at Vassar takes over a tractor. And if she's as pretty as any girl in Hollywood, she's no less effective at her work. A girl from a Manhattan high school handles a hay wagon. She could be having her usual summer vacation, but she'd rather help the nation make hay while the sun shines. And so it goes, day after day, farm after farm, until the precious crops of all kinds are harvested and stored. After a hard day's work, the girls enjoy a well-earned shower before a hearty country supper. Nobody is too little to help. This fellow doesn't like spinach personally, but he's willing to pick it for others. Oh, well, to hell with it. It's a lot of fun for the kids because living on a farm is one adventure after another. First, spinach sticking up out of the ground. And then a real live cow with milk. And then, miracle of miracles, you pour in milk. Turn it around and around. And the stuff changes to butter. If you don't think this is fabulous stuff, watch the little girl's face. Then there is the raking of hay, and everybody goes to work in earnest because gathering hay sooner or later means a hayride. And what's more wonderful to a child after a day of work and fun than a hayride home over farm roads beside beautiful trees? The children get paid in war saving stamps, each according to the amount of work he's done. And it means a lot to them to collect their pay and to stick the stamps in their pay books. They want the war to be over as soon as possible, too, because they want their daddy's home. The end of a perfect day, they gather around the wash tubs on the lawn and scrub their clothes clean for tomorrow, as the older folks are scrubbing the world clean for tomorrow.
It's a new anti-aircraft weapon, smoke screen on wheels. Of course, there's a little more to it. You need a skilled staff of crack GI weathermen and plotters to dope out wind speeds and drift and directions. But it's the generators that make the smoke and do the real business. As a matter of fact, it isn't really smoke. It's a lot better. A kind of chemical stuff which chemical warfare scientists have trained to do damn near exactly what they want it to do. It shoots out of the nozzles, follows the wind, and slowly fills up its own holes and thin spots like a balloon, flattening into one big smoke wall which clings together for as much as 10 miles. A nice thick cloud bank of protection for whatever's going on underneath. Both in methods and size, our anti-aircraft defenses have come a long way from where they were even 6 months ago. The addition of the smoke screen is an important contribution to the security from enemy air attack of military and naval operations or installations.